All rise for the bride. It's my privilege to welcome all of you today to this celebration of God's wisdom and love as Drew and Margaret join their lives together in the covenant of marriage. Since God's the creator of marriage and the sustainer of it, it's fitting that we seek his blessing in this. Pray with me. Father, you're the giver of all good things, including marriage. And so we ask you to look on us with pleasure today as these vows are exchanged. Send your spirit to help us taste your goodness and love. And we ask all this in the kind name of Jesus. Amen. Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
Her mother and I.
Drew, will you please take your bride's hand and join me at the altar? Weddings have a way of putting life into focus. And that's true whether you had a great week or you had a week as crummy as I did. My wife threw her back out. We have 3 kids under 5. My roof sprung a leak, and I fell through the ceiling of my bedroom trying to fix the leak. But the fact is, whether your week was better than mine or was just as bad or even worse, none of that seems to matter now. Weddings have a way of putting life into focus. And for this few brief minutes that we're here together, sharing this space, hearing these same words, something miraculous can happen. Something supernatural, where the beauty of marriage can triumph over our culture of distraction and its tendency to divert us away from the things that really matter. You see, this wedding invites us to pause and consider things like the brevity of life, the state of our relationships, the source of true love, and even the meaning of our existence. First, weddings remind us that life is short. We already know this, but weddings help us feel that reality in a certain way. Consider that all the planning that was done for this day, all the preparations that were made, all the sacrifices given, and all the money spent culminate in a ceremony that lasts some 20 minutes and an after party that's over before you know it. And what then? That would be a depressing thought, if not for an important point too often missed in our short-sighted culture. It's this. Weddings are not the final goal for relationships. Right. Drew and Margaret, you guys haven't arrived. The wedding is just the starting point, not the finish line. And the new life that you will create together today is one that will last until the end. In the same way, every wedding reminds us of the need for a life that endures beyond the grave and the hope that all the planning, all the labor, and all the sacrifice in your few brief years of life were not wasted or done in vain. Nothing in this world can give you that. Only the eternal can give significance to the temporary. And weddings also invite us to consider the true source of love. In fact, they point us to a love that's older than the world, a love that will outlive the love of every bride and groom. Because God himself is love, as the scriptures tell us. And so weddings speaks to us because they are a holy moment when the love of God is on display in beauty and in power. This is true even for those of you here today who do not believe in God or who disdain his gift of marriage. I'm happy to tell you that your unbelief cannot diminish the grace of God any more than a man's blindness could blot out the sun. Because the truth is this, God loves you, even if you do not yet love him. And he has filled his world with 1 billion perfect gifts, many of which we see here today. Food and drink, song and laughter, friendship, marriage, and lovemaking. All these gifts are undeserved, and yet they are given still. Love for the unlovely, grace upon grace. But the greatest of God's gifts is one that marriage uniquely was made to illustrate. It's the gift of salvation, the promise of rescue, the glory of forgiveness, and the guarantee that Jesus will make all things new. This is good news for all those who recognize their need. For like our ancestors in every age, stretching back to the very beginning, you and I are people marked by ignorance and selfishness. It's not pretty, but it's true. We don't know what's good or true or beautiful. And even when we do know these things or have been enlightened in some way, we still fail to act like we know we should. All our thoughts and feelings seem inwardly focused and destructively self-centered. Instead of joy, we tend to bring sorrow. Instead of hope, we feel despair. Instead of humility, we're so often filled with pride. Instead of love, we live in selfishness. And on top of all this, instead of searching the light, we seem to content to live in darkness. And here's where the good news comes in. God, who is rich in mercy and love, did not leave us wandering hopelessly in the dark. Instead, God determined to fix everything that is wrong by means of the most glorious marriage that ever was and ever will be. It's the marriage between Jesus Christ and his bride, the church. And that's why he came, to give himself for us, to redeem us from all wickedness, and purify for himself a people of his very own, who are eager to do what is good, just as the Apostle Paul says in Titus 2:14. That sacred union between Jesus and the church is consummated with the vow of faith and sealed with the ring of baptism, forever reconciling God's people to their Creator, Redeemer, and Lord. In this way, marriage is one of the main metaphors for salvation, since the rescue that we need is found only in Jesus' commitment to join himself forever to his bride, the church. Jesus is noble and sacrificial, as every groom is called to be, and Jesus laid down his life for his bride, as every groom is called to do. The church, in turn, is beautiful and resplendent, like every bride on her wedding day. And finally, Jesus' union with his bride is one that's marked by forgiveness and forbearance, by longing and patience, by sacrifice and love, and by eternal joy. And so too is every marriage that trusts in the wisdom of God, rejoices in his forgiveness, and relies upon his all-sufficient grace. The Apostle Paul points to this connection between marriage and salvation in the fifth chapter of Ephesians. His words there are often quoted in weddings, and unfortunately they're more frequently misunderstood. He tells us there that husbands are called to love their wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. He tells you, Drew, to love your wife and honor her and respect her in the same way that the church joyfully submits to Jesus. In short, every husband and every wife is called to declare and display the gospel in how they treat one another. And depending on the marriage, this declaration is made poorly or made well, but the fact is it's always made. By design, our marriages always point to Christ in the church. And so, Drew, you're called to embody the sacrificial aspect of the gospel. The old vows express this calling with words like, for better or for worse, in sickness and in health, and so on. This means that you are binding yourself here today with the cords of love. You're committing yourself to love Margaret when you feel like it and when you don't feel like it. You're declaring that you will sacrifice yourself for her when it seems like a good idea and when it does not seem like such a hot idea. And all of this is because Jesus loved us with a love that knows how to lead. And so you were called to love your wife in the same way that he loved the church. Remember, Drew, when Jesus died, he was not just inconvenienced in a minor way. When Jesus died, he was not just briefly interrupted. When Jesus died, he gave his bride all that he had to give, including his life. That's the model for husbands, and it's a set of marching orders that should make every man stagger. But if, as you stagger, you cry out for the grace of God, he will help you to fulfill the promise that you're making here today. It's all grace from first to last. Margaret, be eager to follow Drew's lead in this. Don't be so eager that you take the lead. But when he takes the lead, as he's promising to do here today, you should be right there with him. And this is no small task. It's been observed on Dancing with the Stars that the ladies mirror every move their partner makes, only backwards and in heels. In the same way, you're called to honor Drew with a reciprocal love. He offers himself completely, and you gladly receive him and offer yourself completely in return. Drew bows in sacrificial death, and then you curtsy in sacrificial death. He straightens and stands up in resurrected life, and then you join him in this rhythm of faith and repentance. That's the only path of joy that God offers you. So follow the Lord Jesus and follow your husband. For when you respect the man that your husband is, you'll discover the great blessing of God's design. Even when you respect your husband's leadership, despite his failings and his sins, you will discover this is the most powerful exhortation to holiness that a woman could ever render to a man. And God gives this opportunity to you now, Margaret. It's a high challenge and a high gift, but his grace will help you to fulfill it. Let's pray. Father, we are overwhelmed as we consider the grace that you have shown to us. We praise you for all your gifts, especially the gift of marriage. We ask that you would bless Drew and Margaret as they enter into this covenant today. that you would use their marriage to point many people to your son Jesus, and that you would sustain them to endure all trials in their marriage so that your name might be glorified. Amen. Drew and Margaret, in token of your decision of each other as husband and wife, will you give careful attention to the questions I'm asking you? Do you, Drew, take Margaret, the woman of your choice before God, to be your lawful and only wife, pledging in covenant to love her as Christ loved the church, to give yourself up to meet all her needs, to protect her from all harm, and to remain faithful to her in all trials and tribulations until death do you part?
I do.
And do you, Margaret, promise before God to take Drew to be your lawful and only husband, pledging in covenant to love him as the church loves Christ, to honor him faithfully, to help him through all difficulty, and to remain faithful to him in all trials and tribulations until death shall part you?
I do.
Then, Drew and Margaret, if the vows you've chosen represent your hearts, please repeat after me. I, Drew, take you, Margaret.
I, Drew, take you, Margaret.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
With deepest joy.
With deepest joy.
I welcome you.
I welcome you.
Into my life.
Into my life.
That together we may be one.
That together we may be one.
I will be to you.
I will be to you.
A loving and faithful husband.
A loving and faithful husband.
Offering my deepest love.
Offering my deepest love.
My fullest devotion.
My fullest devotion.
My most tender care.
And my most tender care.
I vow always.
I vow always.
To lead you and serve you.
To lead you and serve you.
As Christ does the church.
As Christ does the church.
Since pleasing God.
Since pleasing God.
Is our greatest desire.
Is our greatest desire.
I will live for him.
I will live for him.
Above all else.
Above all else.
Including you.
Including you.
I promise to lead our family.
I promise to lead our family.
Into a life of trusting Christ.
Into a life of trusting Christ.
Honoring God's guidance.
Honoring God's guidance.
By his Spirit.
By his Spirit.
Through his Word.
Through his Word.
And so throughout life.
And so throughout life.
In every trial we may face.
In every trial that we may face.
I pledge to you my life.
I pledge you my life.
As your loving and faithful husband.
As your loving and faithful husband.
Margaret, will you please repeat after me? I, Margaret, take you, Drew.
I, Margaret, take you, Drew.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
With deepest joy.
With deepest joy.
I begin my new life with you.
I begin my new life with you.
As you have pledged.
As you have pledged.
Your commitment to me.
Your commitment to me.
I freely give.
I freely give.
My life to you.
My life to you.
I will respect you.
I will respect you.
And follow you.
And follow you.
As you follow Christ.
As you follow Christ.
I'll live first to honor God.
I'll live first to honor God.
Then to love you.
Then to love you.
To support you.
To support you.
And to care for you.
And to care for you.
Putting your needs.
Putting your needs.
Above my own.
Above my own.
Just as you have pledged.
Just as you have pledged.
To do for me.
To do for me.
By God's grace, I promise.
By God's grace, I promise.
To help, encourage, and serve you.
To help, encourage, and serve you.
As these bring me true delight.
As these bring me true delight.
And so, in every joy and sorrow.
And so, in every joy and sorrow.
That may lie ahead of us.
That may lie ahead of us.
I pledge to you my life.
I pledge to you my life.
As your loving and faithful wife.
As your loving and faithful wife.
May we have the bride's ring, please. Just as the cross is a symbol of the atoning work of Jesus' death and the new covenant, so too this ring is a symbol of the covenantal relationship that you two are now entering into with one another. Notice that there's no unbroken curves to this ring. Nor are there any end to the covenant that you are making before God today. But do not forget that the love of Jesus was not without the agony of the cross, because in the same way, the love of marriage is likewise not without many trials. The Lord Jesus, however, endured the cross for the joy that was set before him. As in marriage, you must endure the hardships that result to the joy of each other and the glory of God. Drew, as you place this token of your love and affection on Margaret's finger, as the woman of your choice, say and pledge after me these words. In token of my choice.
In token of my choice.
Of you as my wife.
Of you as my wife.
I pledge here and now.
I pledge here and now.
This solemn vow.
This solemn vow.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
With loyal love.
With loyal love.
I thee endow.
I thee endow.
All my worldly goods.
All my worldly goods.
With thee I share.
With thee I share.
And promise my fidelity to you.
And promise my fidelity to you.
As long as I shall live.
As long as I shall live.
And we have the groom's ring. Margaret, as you receive and wear Drew's ring and place this token of your love on his finger, Say and pledge after me these words. In view of my acceptance.
In view of my acceptance.
Of you as my husband.
Of you as my husband.
I pledge here and now.
I pledge here and now.
This solemn vow.
This solemn vow.
With this ring.
With this ring.
I thee wed.
I thee wed.
With loyal love.
With loyal love.
I thee endow.
I thee endow.
And promise my devotion.
And promise my devotion.
In the bad that may darken our days.
In the bad that may darken our days.
In the good that may lighten our way.
In the good that may lighten our way.
So long as I shall live.
So long as I shall live.
Drew and Margaret, you've pledged your trust in Christ and your love for each other. You've sealed your marriage vows by giving and receiving rings. Therefore, in view of the vows you published here before God and these witnesses, as a minister of the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, and by the power vested in me, the Commonwealth of the State of Virginia, I do now pronounce you Andrew Stephen Horner and Margaret Page Cox, husband and wife, in interest and destiny as one, so long as you both shall live. You may kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, it's with great joy I present to you for the very first time, Mr. and Mrs. Horner. Yeah.